Yeah, they put their foot on our necks, but we let them, so what you expect? When the last time you picked up a book? When the last time you wrote your own check? Yeah, we all up on IG and Netflix, and the devil, he got you on chill. He's scrolling and trolling your life, you can't see he destroying, cause he got you still. It's your vision that he wanna steal, and your mission that he wanna kill. No condemning, I'm keeping it real, it's conviction I want you to feel. And I'm praying today that we wake up, and the mess that we made, we can make up. It's because of our skin that they hate us, don't know what it's gonna take to shake us. Listen. And I'm not pacing, I'm just patient. They thought that I was moving slow, they didn't know I was waiting. Yeah, it's my season, it's my reason. I talk with God every day, I'm not into people pleasing. If I ever, I'm for God. And I just want you to know without him, life is hard. So get your heart right, get your house in order.
Hi, I'm Charcy Curtis. Some of you may know me as SZA Diva out of Fayetteville, North Carolina. This is the I'm For God Movement podcast, where we allow everyday people to tell their testimony. Today, I have a very special guest with me today. Mr. Jones, are you here?
I am.
Thank you, thank you, thank you for fitting me in your busy schedule. This is the man with a plan when it comes to photography and pictures and all that good stuff. He's in Atlanta. He done left a little old Fayetteville. But once again, thank you so much for fitting me in your schedule. Can you let the people know who you are and what you got going on?
That's a loaded question, but I am Antoine Dwayne Jones, career photographer, Ohio native, but I spent a good many years in Fayetteville as I'm a graduate of the Fayetteville State University, class of 2003. So this is year 20 reunion coming this homecoming next month.
Yes.
So I started my photography career in the South, and I gradually grew that to several other businesses. So all of them are technically photography related, but using that degree that I earned in Fayetteville to branch out and grow my business, and just continue to multiply that and help people on the way.
Okay, before we get started, can you please tell the people about, you have an event coming up, the date and everything in Fayetteville?
Yeah, so this is like a bucket list thing for me. This is one of those opportunities that might not come around for all artists, whether you're a painter or a photographer. So I have an exhibit opening up on October 20th at the Arts Council of Fayetteville. It'll be the whole main gallery. It will just be my work. And the theme is 2079. So if you just imagine what you might think the world could possibly look like in 2079 if we kept going at the trajectory we are going. So that's it. So it's scholarship based. So 40% of the proceeds are going to funnel back into scholarships between North Carolina and Georgia. So I'm advocating that everybody come by the Arts Council of Fayetteville in that time frame, take a look. If something, a piece moves you, you know, purchase a digital image or a hard copy canvas portrait and just enjoy it.
Okay. Congratulations on that too. Can you tell us about the water you have?
Yes.
Yeah, so, by the way, I love it.
Yeah, just we're out there. The shameless plug, the Runner's Water. it was a brainchild of, you know, wanting to, we put all this focus on ourselves, but I mean, I'm 45 years old and I have three kids. So it's time to kind of shift the focus and say, I know I'm gonna build my business with photography and the magazine and award shows and all these other things that I do within my fraternity and community, but let's pause on our primary focus and start putting the focus on these kids, because you know, post-COVID, they're struggling, you know, the job situation looking weird between AI and
down recession
and all this stuff, man. These kids are really, really going to have a hard time with employment, but if you're trying to go work for somebody else. So I was at an award show doing photography, and one of the awardees was the actual owner of this water brand, and he was like, yo, if you really want a private label water brand, talk to me, we can make it happen. So I did the research and I checked it out. I went up there and I looked at it, I seen the whole process, and I took my kids up there, and they were like in awe. I was like, oh yeah, this is a sign that it's time to go ahead and do this. So put it in the family chat group. It was, we need a name, and I wanted to do something for my grandmother's, my two of my grandmothers passed away from cancer. So we put the name together, Runneth, there's Ruth and Nettie, merged those together, and it sounds biblical. They're missionary and evangelist, respectively, so it just all came together.
Okay, congratulations on that, too. And we're going to jump right in these questions.
All right.
Can you tell us a little bit about yourself and how your childhood was growing up, your background? Chat about fun.
I am a native Midwesterner, Youngstown, Ohio, which is about an hour from Cleveland, hour and a half from Cleveland, if you want to go down to an hour and a half from Pittsburgh. So right up there, you know, in northeastern Ohio. I mean, I had a great childhood, honestly. We didn't have a whole lot of money, but we were like middle class in that frame. But you know, my parents are young, so they were still vibrant. They were still busy doing, you know, sports and being athletic and being outgoing. Family that's always together on both sides. So it was just a loving, loving family from any direction. I don't have many relatives that I don't get along with. There's no outcasts in the family. There's no, it, you know, everybody has, you know, their set of issues. But as a family, you know, I haven't run across too many families that had this type of relationship overall as a whole family on any side.
Okay. Well, I want to give you your flowers because I know you raised your kids alone. So I want to give you your flowers now. So how was that as a father raising boys and, well, a girl, with the kids alone? So how did you do that?
So, I mean, I co-parent with the boys' moms. Well, you know, for when I initially, when we initially split, I was still in Fayetteville. So we were doing 50-50. So it was like 1 week on, 1 week off. And that was cool. Kids are resilient. So they adjust much better than adults do. Mm-hmm. Then when I moved to Atlanta, that was a challenge right there, because I took my daughter because she started high school. So from fifth grade until now, which she's now a senior in college, I've had her 1,000% solo dolo, like by myself. Mm-hmm. But I was still living in Fayetteville 1 week out of the month. Mm-hmm. So I was full-time dad down there with all the responsibilities of being a single parent with no nothing but me and then my sister and her family, doing everything to build a business, be in a new city, to grow, learn, meet people, network, then come home, help with homework, do all this stuff, do whatever I needed to do. And then after those 3 weeks over, drive to Fayetteville, catch the boys right before they got out of school, pick them up from school, be full-time dad, still work there, still had a studio there, still pay rent there, do everything I was still doing there a whole entire year. For just to make sure that, you know, my sons especially knew that, you know, their dad loved them, and I moved because I needed to, you know, create more for them. And I just couldn't. I had leveled up in Fayetteville. I can't go any higher in Fayetteville than what I was.
Not, all right.
And I respect Fayetteville. I love Fayetteville. I love the people that helped me get to where I am. But for me, I reached my plateau. I couldn't go any higher, you know. With the people that knew you before you were doing your thing, the people that grew with you, you know, it was like, that's family. So family doesn't necessarily always see, you know, that there's more growth to be had. So I had to get up out of there, and it worked for me.
Okay. I know we was talking before about the statistics about, you know, the black man and, you know, about the fathers.
Yeah, man, that was one of the amazingest thing here. So I'm in a position with my fraternity. I'm the international chairman for the Sigma Fathers Committee for Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated. Mm-hmm. So my duty is to find resources and avenues, you know, to really, really help fathers, whether you're single dad, married dad, girl dad, boy dad, co-parenting, single parenting, all that stuff. I've been kind of researching and trying to come up with avenues, you know, for the betterment of dad. So I've come across all these organizations, you know, the Dad Gang, which we just did a walk with them last weekend, and Dope Dads, all things fathers. And the statistics show you know, that the black man, the brothers, are the most there, you know, of all other ethnicity, not any other. And not that it's a wide margin or any margin, but what the perception is that, you know, all these black baby mamas and the dads ain't doing with their jobs and all that. Mm-hmm. That's just statistically not the case. The black man is there, active. And like I told you in our conversations, you know, just speaking a lot to black men, because I'm around them all the time as far as the parenting goes. But I'm around women more in my job. So 99% of the time I'm around women. So I hear all that stuff and I learn and grow. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to parenting and single dads or single parents, I know a whole lot of single parents, and it's a lot more black men that are single dads, that are stepping up to the plate and raising their kids. Really, because laws are changing, times are changing. Back in the day, when I first became a parent, it was like, oh, the woman's gonna get the kid no matter what. She can be left, sideways, upside down, no crib, no car, no nothing. She was a woman, so she would get the child. But now the courts are really saying, who is the more fit parent? What is the best situation for the child? So a lot of dads are getting the opportunity to really be the primary parent. And again, I'm not saying that dads can raise kids better. To me, honestly, a two-parent home is the best thing you can possibly have, or a healthy two-parent home is the best situation for a child. Because Lord knows, I was struggling as a single dad, but dads are there. They're willing to do it, and I know a whole lot of dads jumping through a whole lot of hoops just to see their kids. But it is what it is, man. I commend dads for stepping up and being primary parents. I also give kudos to dads that are jumping through all kind of hoops, whether it be necessary or unnecessary, just have a relationship with their kids. I understand dads that had to step aside and say, hey man, this ain't healthy for me or my kid or the mom. I had to pull back, and they get heat for that because the dad walked away. It's like, man, the dad, somebody be to kill somebody or some bad situation happened in front of the kid and traumatized the kid because the parents are in so much opposition that it's just not healthy for anybody.
Yeah, I agree. What was that moment like when you fully, truly examined yourself?
Man, I was like, I'm still in my 40s. It takes some time to really, like, I feel most people won't really fully examine themselves until they hit rock bottom. Mm-hmm. Everything is cool. Everything is all peaches and cream. You don't really examine yourself. You just flow on with the good times. But once you really hit rock bottom, you by yourself. Mm-hmm. Like the job ain't going the way you want it to be. And your friends ain't there anymore. And you still got to raise kids and figure out a way to make, to get out of bed and make ends meet. That's when you really find out about yourself. And for me, it took all those failed relationships and business hard and COVID and all that. It really just took some therapy, which I'm a full advocate of, to get you to a point where you can see differently. So, I'm a black male, and we were raised in the church, so everybody loved Jesus, and Lord knows I love him too. But that was the thing that we were taught as black men, which I try to get away from. It's two things, I really, really steer away from. One is that suck it up mentality. Men telling other men to suck it up. Now, I told my son, don't suck up nothing. I hate that phrase. I hate it with a passion. If something's going on, as a man, you have to be able to articulate your emotions, communicate properly, so you're not pent up and holding that thing forever. Mm-hmm. And two, therapy. A lot of people say pray about it, leave it to Jesus and go on, but that ain't really the case. Mm-hmm. God put people on this earth that went to school for 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 years with the specialization to be able to understand the mind, so they can help us navigate through some of those thoughts and circumstances. And typically you'll find out that all the stuff that you're dealing with now was something that you just never got over when you was like 12 or 8. Right. You had all these kind of issues when you were a kid, and you find out that was what shaped your mindset or what you were broken about, and it just comes up in your current relationships or your current attitude about things.
Okay. If the word I was a person or the word we was a person, which one you would say best fit you?
But bad thing is I would be a we person. I know I was put on this earth to serve. So I typically would always want to have that we mentality. How can I help my kids? How can I help my community? How can I help my frat brothers? How can I help my sorority sisters? I'm always in we mode. Even in photography, I'm trying to, can I get a hairstylist involved, a makeup artist involved, a wardrobe stylist, a photographer, videographer? I'm trying to get all these people because I feel that, together we can win.
Right.
By, by yourself is hard, you know, hard, hard.
Right. Have you ever been in a dark place? And if so, how did you pull yourself out of it?
Man, therapy, you know, absolutely. Okay. You know, I've being living in two different states for that year of time, I was already kind of in a dark place. Cause like I said, I had kind of capped out where my growth in Fayetteville, but my bank account didn't say that I was capped out. My bank account was like, bro, you need to figure out something to do. And, so I was really, really dark. I, you know, divorced, and I had my daughter, you know, got my daughter back in between the divorce, and I left teaching that in high school marketing. So it was like all this stuff happened at once. I went to divorce, got a kid solely, and transitioned out of having a job to totally 1,000% entrepreneur. So I was like crazy depressed. But you know, I would go through periods where I just had to like, I just wasn't doing anything at all for 2 or 3 weeks, just laying in the bed, or I get up to, you know, play the role with the kids, and then I'm right back in the bed. But again, like I said, therapy really helped. And my brother-in-law, who, you know, I've talked to, and, you know, he would get me straight. So, you know, it's been some dark days, but, you know, you find that strength to keep it going. And then my thing was, once you start serving other people, then you realize that, you know, your situation ain't as bad as what you think it is once you start serving other people who are hurting and got stuff going on too. So that's another therapy for me is trying to, you know, help others. Because again, I'd be complaining, man, dang, business is slow and blah, blah. And then people like, man, I just lost my mom. I got cancer. You know, you'd be like, oh, okay, let me stop tripping. And
right.
There really are people out there that's got way worse stuff than a couple of other, you know, problems. They got health issues, or, you know, I know people going through divorce. I know people dealing with, you know, addictions and all kind of stuff. So it just brings you back to a point where you're like, man, okay, let me stop tripping and get off my shoulders and do better.
Right, right. What keeps you grounded?
Knowing that you got, you know, responsibilities, man. Just everybody wants their kids to be better than what they are. So, you know, I look around, see kids and love, and I'd be like, okay, I can, you know, it's something to look forward to every day. And I keep myself busy too. So I might be one of the busiest people in the world, but that's not because I'm just trying to be busy. It's because, you know, as a creative, which I think you are, you know, most of the people we know are, because we know a million entrepreneurs, but keeping yourself busy, a creative mind busy, keeps that mind from wandering off into some other spaces that it shouldn't be in. Because just as creative as we are to create, like I create amazing pictures, people say, and I do all this, and I got people flying through the air and all these other things. This same brain can, you know, create the worst thoughts in the world about life, and the world is coming to an end in my brain. I can't do it anymore. It does the same. It has the same large capacity to create good and bad. So
right. It starts in the mind.
Oh, yeah, without a doubt. Okay. So I keep myself busy to not be sitting at home thinking like, dang, man, what am I going to do tomorrow? Or what if this happens? Or what if that happens? But if I got stuff going on, I'm helping other people, and I'm creating, and, you know, I love to see people smile, and I love listening to people, you know, in their situation, and trying to help any way I can. So that keeps me going.
I like to tell people, you know, if you have something negative going on, find a positive out of it regardless. Just make it into a positive. Just find something that'll help you a lot. What is something that you asked God for and you wish you could have been a little bit more specific about it?
Man, I think 90% of us that's been divorced is going to say you know, some type of relationship. But, you know, it's and not that anything is bad, because, like you said, the positive in relationships is, one, kids. But two, when you really get older and step back, you say, you know, the persons or people that I've been in relationship with, whether there was love relationships or friend relationships or business relationship, I chose them.
Right.
You know, so when you start asking God for specifics, and those specifics get a little more, look, I'm going to make up a word, get more specific. Older you get, you start asking God, like, okay, I want to be in business with, I want a partnership in my business. Like, no, you want a partnership that's fruitful, equal, fruitful. Like you come up with all these things now, as opposed to, yeah, I just want a partnership. And like you get that partner, and that partner ain't the partner that was for you. Because if you was in a situation that put you further back, now you gotta start from negative 100 just to get back to zero, then start moving and growing. But I'm thankful for, I can't say, most people, if you knew what you then, now what you knew then, all that kind of stuff, would you do it again? And if as much as the world and everything is entangled in there, you really can't take nothing out. Like I take out meeting my daughter's mom. If I could take
Because it
that
make you
out,
who you are today.
I don't have a daughter that's, college magna cum laude. I don't know. Like, so there's nothing you can really take out. You might have done a few things differently, but as an overall thing, you change the whole fabric of who you are if you back and change anything, majorly.
How did you turn your pain into power?
I mean, again, helping other people.
Okay.
You find out that you're going through divorce, and then you look up and somebody else that you know is going through divorce, or you fall on your face with business, and you have somebody else, or somebody, especially younger kids, that you can try to help them, not hit this brick wall or that brick wall. And same thing with your kids. Like I said, I got a 21-year-old now. It's like, okay, this is life. What do you need from me that I can help you make sure that you don't brush your head up against the wall like I did?
What would you like people to know about you that they don't know?
Man, what? Look, my life is kind of open. My personal life is private. But my business life makes it seem like everybody knows me. But I mean, I'm really kind of a loner. I mean, I do the majority of this stuff by myself. So, what don't they know? That probably the last decade I have, been working through depression, because they see the smile, they see the helpfulness, they see the businesses, and they see all the celebrity photographer, and everybody thinks that everything is all gravy. But if you let people know, that you've been through something, or you're going through something, or you're bouncing back and steadily working on being a better person, then that gives people, hope. I didn't talk to two, three people this week that was like, yo, man, I was just about to end it. And I'm like, man, we 40 something years old with kids. Like,
That's cock out.
it ain't really an option. But man, this post-COVID, people were stuck at homes, jobs, money situation, kids been in the house the whole time, they bouncing off the walls. People are really, really stressed out. I mean, people are really, really, really depressed. And if you're not talking about it with a professional, or at least confiding your family and friends to try to see you through that, man, what's going on in your mental? That's big. So yeah, I'm a staunch mental health advocate. Like, if you need therapy, especially as a minority, black and brown folks, man, go get help from a professional. Don't try to take all this stuff on your own, because we're not trained to handle all the situations that come in the mind. We just not. We pray for a good therapist, if you need to, whatever you do. But it's help out there if we quit being scared and worried about what people think. Because at the end of the day, those people that think something don't really care. They just think, I mean, they got comments, and everybody got Twitter fingers, and everybody has an opinion. But that opinion doesn't really move anything in your personal life. It might make you mad at the most, but it doesn't change your reality. It doesn't change your financial situation. It doesn't change your mental stability. It's just people talking.
Yeah, that's why I tell people you gotta definitely surround yourself with positive people, because the negative ones will take you all the way down. It's so draining. What would you like the people to well, what's so different about the old you versus the new you? What would you say?
Man, it's not really much different. It's just, I guess it's a little bit more confidence. When you're young, arrogance is the supplement or the replacement for confidence. You're not, most people are just arrogant. They're not really confident. And then once you go through a whole bunch of stuff and they take you all the way down to the basement, then you have to build up that true confidence, that true self-esteem. So I've worked on that, the last couple of years, especially, really last year in general, and been through a lot. And it was like, okay, it's time to really stand tall and walk into, I put in the work as far as my career. I put in the work as a parent. Just confidence needs to be there because, you know, everybody else say they see it, but you're looking in the mirror like, what is, I need to see it. So that's what I've really been working on.
Okay. What was that moment like when you realized God was real without a shadow of a doubt? Give us a testimony.
And I know God was real for my whole life. Now, like I said, I grew up in the church, but, you know, we be knuckleheads sometimes. We the prodigal child syndrome has happened a couple of times, but, you know, I've been in situations where, even not to get too holy, but I've been in situations where I know, you know, God has saved me. God has showed me some things and I've seen them come to pass. So it's I know the world gets confusing. And you know, we get so much information that, you know, now that we have the internet and social media and all that stuff, yeah, everything's God, the book's God, the God's God, the stars God, everything's God, everything's God, everything, nobody know nothing, everything's fake, you know what I'm saying? But you know, when you were riding in the car, and God told you to do something, or you were dreaming, and God told you to go talk to your neighbor and speak life into them, or God told you to turn left, and then you turn left, and you seen that car accident on the right, you know, it's those little, those situations that you know for without a shadow of a doubt that God is real.
Right. What's more important to you, loyalty, love, or respect?
Man, love. I mean, the other ones don't really amount to anything because I mean, all those things could change. Respect and loyalty could change tomorrow. Your best friend could be loyal to you today and not tomorrow, and people could respect you. You know, until it's convenient for them not to. So love, like you said, love never fails. Even being divorced and going through all kind of stuff, I still believe in love on every level, agape love, relationship love. You know, it's there because I know that I have it in me. So even me can work on that to do better. But, you know, love is a constant if we just apply it right.
What was your first thought when you first seen the word for God?
Man, I was like, well, from a Christian standpoint, you know, man, that was so dope, you know. And again, it makes you stop and say, yo, man, let me you know, analyze myself, you know, because. You were like one of the first people, you know, everybody got a little t-shirt brand now and I ain't trying to take away from nothing, but you've been rocking this thing for like a decade. You know what I'm saying?
I love you for that.
Right. People were scared to put God on their shirts back in the day. Listen. You know, oh, I love Jesus and everybody got, you know, faith works and all this stuff now. But, you know, man, you about 10, 12 years in this thing, rocking God on your chest proudly. And everybody wasn't bold enough to do that. You know, so like you said, even with, you know, the disciples or God, you know, everybody not gonna walk this thing out. Everybody can't proudly, you know, proudly represent God, you know, and say I love God like out loud and proud. You know, I love God in the corner. I love God when He do something for me, when He saved me this time. You know, and He got me out of this trouble. But if you ask them to, you know, to sport it on their chest or their back or they're not really doing that. So
I thank you for so much for all the photography you did behind I'm for God. Said, you know, right now is that moment that we have to say who we for. Either you form or you're not.
Right.
So, you know, that's the whole point of it. But leave the people with something positive.
Man, I can say that, you know, if you work, I substitute words now, you know, people say hustle. I don't say hustle. I'm a grinder. I'm a grind, and I know that hard work does ultimately pay off. You may not think it might not, like you said, he might not come when you want him to, but he's always
all the time.
It is so. You know, I felt like when I was boohooing in my bed by myself, driving to Fayetteville and sleeping on the floor on the couch and all that, I was like, man, what am I doing all this for? Man, I should be rich right now. I should be a millionaire, but you know, that just wasn't. This wasn't the time, but now, you know, I'm almost 19 years into photography, and so I'm definitely closer to retirement than than the beginning, but it's like, man, the doors that I've been wanting to open for years and years are starting to, they're starting to blossom. They're not bursting open, which is cool. They're blossoming in their season, just like a flower or a rose would do. So I'm just continually planting seeds. All I can do is do people right and do the best I can possibly do. I have my challenges and I try to fight through those, but you can do it. You have the power. God has given you the skills, the mind to do whatever it is. And the last thing I want to say is, especially for like kids, that's like my ministry right there, teens and tweens. Man, if you find something that you love to do, and that's what you get paid for, especially with the way the world is going with, jobs, and you might work for a company 20 years, they shut down. Now people, they didn't work this company for 20 years, and the company gone now, so they ain't getting no pension and all that stuff. So they have all this loyalty into this building or these people, and they gone, or they didn't fire you, and then they didn't hire some robots or some kid that's 5 years old to do the same thing you're doing that you've been doing for 20 years. So, man, if you can do it, everybody's not an entrepreneur, I understand that. But if you find something that you love to do, man, do that for pay. Do
No, I
that.
agree. I agree. And you're rich in spirit. I'd rather be rich in spirit than rich. Not many
Yeah,
rich people are so depressed.
I
So
want to be
yeah.
wealthy. That's what it is, wealthy right now. When you walk in somewhere and your name just, I want my kids to be like, "Oh, you Jones? Okay, you good. Don't even worry about it." That's where I want to be.
We are biggest critics anyways, but you definitely you're doing more than what you think, So at the end of the day, I'm congratulating you. Like I said, keep doing what you're doing, being that motivation for a lot of people more than you think. And thank you so much for tuning in and helping, with this whole interview. I will have you back in the future. And please, can you give them information about how to get in contact with you far as for the water or your photography or whatever? Can you drop that
Yeah,
before we
so
leave?
my personal brand is, ADJ Media. That's Antoine Dwayne Jones, Antoine Dwayne Jones. That's across every platform: TikTok, Instagram, Facebook, and then the fan page, Antoine Dwayne Jones Media. On the water end, the runneth water. That's simple: RUNNETH Watcher Co.com or runnethwater.co on all other social media platforms.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And thank y'all for tuning in. Like I always say, I love you, but God loves you more. Until next time, take care.